It's when we first see him at the Bema seat, or if we get to meet him in the air through the rapture. And that sure seems to be getting closer and closer. So we look forward to that day, and I hope every day you're just wondering, is it going to be today? Because one day it's going to happen. Thanks for supporting our ministry. We really do appreciate that. We don't pass an offering plate here, so if you want to donate, please put your gifts and offerings in that box hanging on the back wall, and we will take care of them. It is wonderful to see the support that you give our church. Tuesday nights are prayer time, 6 o'clock. Please come if you can. It is a great time just to lift up the needs of our church and pray over what's going on. If you can't attend, you can send your prayer request to us at prayer@truthfellowshiplive.com, which is an email, or you can just text them to one of us, and we will pray for them. And we do certainly appreciate the prayer requests that we get midweek, after Tuesday. We still pray about those. So if you've got something that comes up Wednesday, Thursday, Friday or something, please do send those to us and we will circulate those and pray for them. It is just a great opportunity for us. Please do continue to pray for Truth Fellowship Live, our unity as a church, our ability to stand strong in these very difficult times, and pray for our country, which is really at a crossroads right now. So I do pray for those things. Fellowship dinners, there was one last week, I think, in the back of the church, in the fellowship room. There are others coming up, so if you're a host of one of those, please do get your people together and decide when you want to do it. If you haven't signed up yet, since there are fellowship groups that haven't met, you can sign up and we'll get you into one of those groups. You can see Janelle or Rita to get signed up. We're going to have a spring cleanup Saturday, May 11th. Last year I said it would start at 9, people came at 8. So this year I'm going to say it starts at 8, but I may not be there at 8. But we'll do the spring cleanup and just go around the whole property, clean everything up, trim it up, edge, do whatever we have to do. last year we were done before noon, so it doesn't take a tremendous amount of time. We've got some trimming to do and things like that. I do ask you to bring your own tools. So whatever you think you could use, bring it and use it wherever you think it needs to be used. So that'll be May 11th. So put that on your calendars. The stewardship committee has been working hard on our finances, trying to figure out how we spend money, where we spend it, and building a budget. And we finally reached the end of that, and we would like to present to the congregation what our budget looks like. You know, through the years, you've never really had a look at that, but we feel confident to come before you with that. And so we're going to do that on Sunday, May 19th, after the service. And the head of our committee, Rick, is going to kind of lead that, so it won't be very long. He doesn't run those things on and on and on. So we will have that meeting. I suppose it'll last 10 or 15 minutes after the service on May 19th. So everybody's invited to that. We don't want to hide anything from the congregation, so come with your questions if you have questions. And we'll just discuss those issues and show you what our budget looks like. Our basic Bible study class meets Wednesday nights at 7. We're up to week 8 this week, so it's almost over. But if you want to listen to the old classes, they are available to you online. Even if you want to come at this late date, I wouldn't stop you from doing that. So So we do meet Wednesdays at 7. So come if you want, or let me know and we'll get you hooked up online. Men's group meets Thursday at 6. You can always see John Leet for more information on that. Women's Bible studies on their normal schedule. Good, good, good. Volunteer schedules are on the back table for April, May. Please do look at those, and if you've got a duty, a task that you're assigned to that you can't do, please do find a substitute and then write that on the bulletin board up at the top of the stairs. Vacation Bible study Bible school is gearing up. It starts June 2nd. It'll run June 2nd through the 5th, 6 to 8 p.m. each night. Hometown Nazareth, where Jesus was a kid. It's going to be a blast. You still need tribe leaders, I'm sure. Okay, so we didn't say much about it, but, you know, being a tribe leader is not that hard a job. I don't think you have any real responsibility other than getting the kids from one place to another. And that involves a rope and a whip. And then you can herd your kids to where they've got to go. So basically you're a herder of kids. And it's not a bad job. You know, you help the kids out. It works well. So we need volunteers. So please do volunteer for that and get that done. Please do see your bulletin for other details and to remind you of what's going on during the week at TFL. Psalm 148, 13 and 14 says, "Let them praise the name of Yahweh, for his name alone is exalted. His glory is above the earth and heaven, and he has exalted the horn of his people, the praise of all his saints, of the children of Israel, a people near and dear to him, praise Yahweh." Israel is still near and dear to God's heart. And as we see what's going on over there and see God guiding his people, pray for them. Because Yahweh, we've read the end of the story. He wins. That's the whole thing. So Israel is his people. They still are. Pray for them as they go through some very, very difficult times. Let's pray. Oh, Yahweh, we are so pleased to come into your presence, to worship with you, to study your word, to get to know one another. Lord, we do stand in support of Israel. We know they have difficult times, but they are your people. They are your children. And Lord, we pray for their safety and for their ability to come back into the land in preparation for the next future events, the tribulation and then the millennial kingdom. And Lord, we look forward to those things. And Lord, we do pray that you come and gather up your church soon. Lord, we could see nothing more wonderful than that. Now encourage us during this time of worship. Help us to keep our focus fully on you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So holy, what does the Bible mean when it says that Yahweh Elohim is holy? What do we sing? What do we mean when we sing that Yahweh is holy? I'd venture to guess that many Christians today, if you ask them what it means when God is holy, that they would say that God is without sin. And that's certainly a part of it, but it's only a part of what it means that Yahweh Elohim is holy. In fact, I'd venture to guess that Pastor Terry, if he did topical sermons, which he doesn't, he could do 10 sermons on that. And that's a low estimate. But I'm serious. But what I mean to say is that God's holiness, it's a broad and it's a serious topic, and it's a serious attribute of Yahweh, and it requires long and focused consideration and study. In fact, it's probably not possible to define Yahweh's holiness in a paragraph or two. But as we sing our next song, which speaks of God's holiness throughout the song, I found a paragraph that I think would help us think and try to help prepare our minds on what it means that God is holy. It's written by a fellow in the UK. His name is Paul Coxall, and he's currently a Bible teacher. So he summarized it in three sections, and section one was called God is Incompatible with Sin. He's trying to summarize holiness, God's holiness. God is incompatible with sin. Holiness means all sin will be judged, and God is incomparable to anything or anyone. And that one really caught my attention. Then he wrote this one paragraph that I'd like to share with you, and I really think it helps set our mindset as to what God's holiness is. Here it is. Holiness means that God stands alone. His name is separate and distinct. Holiness sets God apart from his creation, distinguishing him from everything and everyone. God is unique. All we are and have is a gift from him, but he needs nothing outside of himself. He is both self-existent and self-sufficient. I'd like to add, although God is self-sufficient and he doesn't need anything else, he does desire a relationship with his creation. And then I'd just like to share a couple of verses with you. 1 Samuel 2:2, Hannah is praying to Yahweh and thanking him for providing her son, who would be the great prophet Samuel. And she prayed, "No one is holy like you, Yahweh. There is none besides you, nor is there any rock like our God." Exodus 15:11, "Who is like you, O Yahweh, among the gods? Who is like you, glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders?" Revelation 15:2-4, John said, "And I saw something like a sea of glass mingled with fire, and those who have the victory over the beast, over his image and over his mark and over the number of his name, standing on a sea of glass, having harps of God. They sing the song of Moses, who was the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, 'Great and marvelous are your works, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O King of the saints. Who shall not fear you, O Lord, and glorify your name? For you alone are worthy.'" And finally, Psalms 86:8-10, it really doesn't call God holy directly, but I think it's a great call to worship, and there's a couple attributes in there about God's holiness. "Among the gods there is none like you, O Lord, nor are there any works like your works. All nations whom you have made shall come and worship before you, O Lord, and shall glorify your name. For you are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God. Teach me your way, O Yahweh, I will walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. I will praise you, O Lord my God, with all my heart, and I will glorify your name forever." Let's stand and glorify his name.
Commands all the hosts of heaven. Who else could make every king bow down? Who else could whisper and darkness tremble? Only a holy God. What other beauty demands such praises? What other splendor outshines the sun? What other majesty rules with justice? Only a holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the consumes like fire. What other power can raise the dead? rescue me from my failure? Who else would offer his only son? And who else invites me to call him Father? Only a holy God, only my holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the
Good morning, church. Thank you, Nate, for that. That was really good. Praise and worship, I don't know if that's what we call it, singing. It always puts me, it gets me, even if I come to church, I don't know if you guys feel like that, I come to church and maybe I'm not really engaged. I might not even want to be here. I don't know if any of you feel that ever. But you get praise and worship like that, and now I'm in. I'm in. I'm fully committed. And maybe that's the reason for it. I don't know. I didn't make this stuff up, but I know that's what it does to me. So hopefully you feel the same. I'm 100% in. So hopefully you're in with me. I'll get you prepared here for the scripture readings, right? There's three places we need to go. 2 Timothy chapter 4, Philippians chapter 1, and Psalm 116. So make notes there because you're going to need to read it with me, okay? Because I make mistakes, and then you need to correct me if I miss a word. So that's your job today. And if you don't have a Bible, get one. We have them in the back of the church. Make sure you have it in your hands. Before we do that, we want to do some prayer requests, and then praises. What's God doing in our lives that we can acknowledge Him for and give Him praise for that? But there's also needs that we have. So what do we have?
Amy and Reggie still have the flu and would like our prayers.
One of my friends, his kid is about like 5 or 6, was diagnosed with like leukemia. So, yeah, pray for them and their family. It's taking a toll off. So.
I just want to ask for prayer for some health issues I'm having.
Our friend Jean is deploying to Jordan in a couple weeks. Not the safest spot.
Christian Women's Retreats next weekend, and they can use your prayers.
A friend of ours, Kern Reynolds, is in the hospital with a bad infection and not doing well.
Okay. Kern Reynolds.
Had two cataract surgeries and all the drops and the tests to go with it and everything has turned out excellent.
All right.
The eyes of a 15-year-old.
Faith has come down with another UTI. So just pray for that and the antibiotics on her system.
All right.
I have a doctor's appointment Thursday, and just pray that I get answers for the health issues I'm having.
Joey, do you have another one?
I was praying for Danielle.
Okay.
She got me first.
All right. You get a 2-for-1 deal there.
Yep.
We keep praying for Adam's brother-in-law, Chris. Yep. He's still going through cancer treatment and chemotherapy.
All right. All right. Well, if you just bow with me, and we will pray.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you as a church body this morning, Lord, and we're all praying in unison as one voice to you, Lord, and we know you hear all of our prayers. And Lord, we have a list here this morning, and we just ask that you pay attention to these and solve these issues in whatever way that is right, and that we can understand those ways and give you glory for whatever the outcome is. Lord, we pray for Amy and Reggie both having the flu. You just give them a speedy recovery. Help them with all those, just to get through all of those symptoms that come along with the flu. Give them the strength back and put them back in full health. Lord, we just ask that you be with this young kid, 5 or 6 years old, that's battling leukemia. Be with him as he's trying to understand what is going on in his body and why he is sick. Then be with the parents and the loved ones and the doctors that are trying to be with him and encourage him, encourage the have people around that can encourage the family. And only place the best treatment and the best doctors in this little boy's life and get him through that. I don't know really what to say. It's just that, hey, we give it all to you. You'll deal with it. We do pray for Jody also with the health issues going on there. Again, just put the very best people in place, and then we just ask for your healing hands on her to deal with it, and increase Jody's faith through that process. We do pray for Gene, who's getting deployed into Jordan, right into the belly of the beast, and we just ask you keep them safe, keep them him and all the service people that are with him, just keep them safe, give them a mission and a moral objective in something like this to keep their spirits high. Know that there is right and wrong in this world, and they're on the side of right. So keep them encouraged through that. We do pray for the Christian Women's Retreat, that be something that gives you glory, that it that all the women who do attend that come out changed people, that they come out of that retreat with a closer relationship with you. That's the purpose, Lord, and we just ask that you be in that with them. We do pray for Karen Reynolds that is trying to fight an infection in her body. Lord, we know you are the one who can break any infection. That they just, the viruses and the infections, they just falter at your command. And we just ask that you can work through them. We do give you praise with Ralph and his cataract surgery and the eye drops and all of that. That has been great. We give you praise for that. We know that your hands were in it, and we love that. And we give you just the that can be worked in all these people's lives, that they can come out of these things and just point to you 100%. You are the reason for that. And we do pray for Faith as she's fighting another UTI, and that the antibiotic and the whatever they're going to give her to fight that it does its job and it doesn't have any side effects, but that she can get through that and it be quick and not painful. Do pray for Danielle as she has a doctor's appointment and she's looking for answers of what the docs can do as far as her health is concerned. And again, we just say, God, it's in your hands. You know, you'll take care of your children, and you'll make sure that she's taken care of. And Lord, we have faith in that. And we do pray for Chris, who has cancer and is going through that treatment. And we just ask that wherever he's at spiritually, that this process, though tough, though draining physically and mentally, would be the answer to his faithfulness in you. That the relationship is the answer to whatever we're going through, and maybe that's it. And that you will take care of that cancer, and then in turn, you'll have a very faithful servant. In turn, or we just, oh man, there's just so much of this. Our bodies are boy, they're destined for the grave. And with all this sickness and illness and all that, Lord, it's just evident that we just don't have much time. So, Lord, we just ask you, help us get our focus right. Now's the time to get our focus on you. And maybe that these things that the tribulations that we go through with health, maybe that's just pointing us towards, maybe let's get serious. Let's get other people serious about your word and who you are. And time is short. Time is so short. Lord, we just thank you and praise you for all the opportunity. We thank you for the opportunity just for us to get together on this Sunday morning and pray for these things that people have need for. Lord, we thank you. And as we dive into the scripture, let's just be a blessing to us. And in turn, as we take it seriously, be a blessing to you. We just thank you and praise you. Amen. I did not have that much coffee this morning. Nate, you did this to me. I'm in. I'm in, brother. All right. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6. For I am ready, already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all those who have loved his appearing. Now, if you go with me to turn to the left, Philippians chapter 1, verse 21. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I live on in the flesh, this will mean fruit from my labor. Yet what I shall choose, I cannot tell. For I am hard-pressed between the two, having a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. Nevertheless, to remain in the flesh is more fruitful to you. Now, Psalm 116. This is a short one. Verse 15. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Lord, your scripture is amazing, way beyond my understanding. But with the help of Pastor Terry and the Holy Spirit, we can arrive at conclusions of what you're trying to tell us. Well, we just love being here. And Lord, I know that there are many, many, many things that were not brought up today in prayer. There are those that were not, that people didn't vocalize, but we know that battle, that fight that Paul was in, is the fight that we're in now. It's a battle. It's a battle on the spiritual level. It's a battle on the marital level. It's a battle on the parental level. It's a battle on the occupational level. Lord, and it's the attacks keep coming, and we're in a fight. And Paul gives us inspiration that we can get through it. And as in a race, there will be an end. And are we going to reach our chest out and cross that ribbon? Or are we going to even enter the race? Lord, and that's our challenge. Lord, and Pastor Terry, just help us get this through our minds. What is Paul trying to tell us here? What is this race? What is this fight? And what is that righteous crown that all of us should desire? And we just thank you for the opportunity to come here. And I just pray that what we learn, we get out on the streets, we tell our people. Thank you. Amen.
Well, Chris, we'll get there, but not today. You always want way more than I can give. That would be a long day to cover all that. Good morning. It's good to see you. Really good. And I do mean that sincerely. I think you and Faith were drinking out of the same cup this morning. well, hopefully you have a copy of the bulletin with you so you can follow along with me. Got some good stuff to cover, though, this week, this morning. But I want to tell you about a text I received this week. I received a text with some photos from one of you in this congregation this week. And there were some photos attached. And the photos were of a middle-aged man. He was a big fellow. He was dressed in a pink leotard and a purple tutu. He had graying long hair, was gathered in the back of his head into a ball, pinned in a bun at the back of his head. He looked absolutely bizarre. It was pathetic. I can't imagine how any man in his right mind would actually dress up like that in such a get-up and allow himself to be photographed like that. However, that was not all what that situation was about. There was a lot more to it. In fact, there was a lot more to it. That was actually a minor part of what that situation entailed. A middle-aged man dressed like that. And the biggest part of that story was much more shocking and repulsive, because that was a photo of a man dressed that way who was a professor in the Wahpeton School of Science dental hygiene classroom, supposedly teaching dental hygiene students in their class. Someone in the classroom, one of the students, obviously captured these photos of their professor parading up and down the aisle of their classroom, dressed in whatever dress it was that he was supposed to be dressed up for class, to teach their class that particular day. The looks on the students' faces were anything from what I could tell as I expanded the photo, anything from mortification to utter disgust. What a huge distraction. Can you imagine being a dental hygiene student? What an obstacle that ridiculous, self-centered goof is bringing to these students in the dental hygiene program who have worked hard to get into that dental hygiene program. I know, because Dick and Phyllis's daughter, our daughter-in-law, went to that program, graduated from that program a number of years ago, and it wasn't at that time an easy program to get into. It was a very difficult program. And they worked hard to get into it. It was at that time a very significant training program, a professional training program to train them for a professional field so that they could go out and get jobs and raise their families and live normal lives. But that kind of bizarre foolishness is, I'm afraid, getting quite close to home. Wahpeton, North Dakota is our doorstep. Could easily be Bismarck. Something like that will probably happen very soon here. What will happen when it does? What will we do? Will we complain about it? Do nothing? Or will we at least rise up and protest and try to put a stop to it and try to postpone the destruction of our own society here in North Dakota and Bismarck? I don't know. Amazing. Awful. Frustrating, to say the least. However, I think we all know, don't we, that our best efforts will in the end be rather futile. and society will continue to progress more and more in this debauched direction. It really behooves us to deepen our commitment to learning Yahweh's word more and more fully, teaching our children and our grandchildren to more and more effectively learn Yahweh's word, what it teaches, and embrace it as fully as we can so that we can live our lives and stand more firmly upon it as society continues to grow more wicked. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11 describes all of us as believers in Christ living in this world as pilgrims and sojourners. By that, Peter means that we're just traveling on our way through this world. We are travelers. We're on our way through. We aren't citizens in this place. We don't put our roots down here. We are citizens of heaven, and we just are traveling through. We don't get attached to anything very deeply here. We need to adopt that view of life that holds that kind of thinking. Some people would call it a fatalistic view of life. In fact, some people would think that adopting that kind of biblical view of life is a kind of mental illness. In fact, that's what they call it, fatalistic. And it's a term to mental illness by some. This world is not our home. We're just passing through. Peter and Paul would have certainly been labeled as having that fatalistic kind of thinking, and they would have certainly been labeled as being a kind of mentally ill person. But that's the way Paul lived his life, isn't it? The book of Philippians, I had Chris read it for us. Paul said, "For me to live is Christ, to die is better, to die is gain." He went on to say, "But if I live on in the flesh, that would mean fruit from my labor, yet what shall I choose? I can't even decide," he said. "I can't tell. I'm hard-pressed between the two. Having a desire to depart and be with Christ, that's far better for me. Nevertheless, I suppose if I remain in the flesh, that's more needful for your sake. So I guess I don't know which to do." Paul wrote those words while he was imprisoned, house arrest there in Rome, the first Roman imprisonment. That was in 62 AD. He actually wished then that he could be done with his life on earth. That's the in the flesh part. He wished he could die. He wished he could go ahead and just go to heaven, be with Christ at that point. But obviously, Yahweh had something different in store. Yahweh had 5 or 6 more years of life on earth for Paul to conduct the rest of his ministry that Yahweh had in store for Paul. But now we've come in our point in our study of the book of 2 Timothy to Paul's last will and testament. We've come to 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. This was written about 7 years after Paul wrote those verses in Philippians 1. Paul knows that his time, the time of his death, has come. His physical death is imminent. He knows he will die soon. He doesn't know exactly when, but he knows his death is imminent. He will not be released from prison. We don't know exactly how he knows this, but he clearly knows that it's going to happen. My thinking is that he probably knows by direct revelation from Yahweh, the Holy Spirit himself. I can't say that with any direct authority. It's not written anywhere. I just get that impression quite clearly from the confidence and the clarity with which Paul writes 2 Timothy 4, verses 6 through 8. These verses just are written with such absolute clarity and direct speech. There's just no room for any kind of question about what's going to happen in these verses. Paul's physical life is going to end soon. He says it. He says it directly. He knows it. He knows that he's going to be transported to heaven. He's going to be with Christ soon. His body's going to remain on earth, of course. He knows that. Parts of the process, he says, are already, in fact, having begun. They've already been put in place. Some part of it is already completed. He tells us he knows that. I don't know if Paul's seen it or if he knows some part of it. He's been shown it. He's been told it. I don't know, but it seems likely to me he's been given pretty clear inside information about this whole deal, and verses 6 to 8 makes it clear that there's a whole lot more that Paul is saying than just that he's about to die. He's saying that he has been given some pretty clear information, and he's stating it here. So are you ready to take a little closer look at verses 6 through 8? Ready to do it? All right, let's do it. Verse 6. For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand. All right, any of you know enough about a drink offering that you're ready to come up here and tell the congregation what a drink offering is and what Paul is talking about here? Anybody? Any takers? No takers? No drink offering experts out there? Interesting. Well, I kind of assumed that that would be the case. You know why? Because I knew nothing about a drink offering either. And I realized as I studied this passage, I didn't know a hill of beans about a drink offering. And I sat there looking at this passage and thinking, I think I probably better study what a drink offering is before I get up there and make a fool out of myself not knowing what a drink offering is. So I began digging. And I dug out all of the books and everything that I had on drink on sacrifices and offerings in the Old Testament Mosaic Law system. And I actually had quite a bit of stuff. I didn't realize I had quite as much as I have in my library about it. And the more I dug, the more I realized I have never really known much of anything at all about drink offerings before I did my little drink offering study excursion. And I ended up spending quite a number of hours, and I'm not joking, hours, reading and studying about sacrifices and offerings. It was boring at times, I admit. Fascinating and interesting at other times. But when I finally began to understand drink offerings and what they were, and finally began to understand what Paul is talking about here in verse 6, well, my friends, I have to tell you, I began to giggle and laugh out loud a little bit. And I even let out a couple of cheers and shout-outs to Yahweh. This is actually pretty incredible stuff, this statement. What Paul says in this little statement in verse 6 is actually worth the price you paid to come to this sermon this morning. It really is. The whole sermon, I mean it. What I'm going about to tell you about drink offerings, I expect that you should, I want to hear a big amen or a praise Yahweh or a hallelujah from all of you at the end of this when I tell you about drink offerings, okay? We have a deal? All right, okay. So, drink offering. Well, it turns out that drink offerings didn't even come into play in the Mosaic law system, sacrificial system, until the Israelites were actually in the land. In other words, from Mount Sinai, where the law was given all the way through the 40 years, until they actually got into the land, the drink offerings weren't even really done much. I mean, they may have been done a little bit, but it wasn't until they got into the land that the drink offerings came into being. Why not, you ask, right? Well, it's because the drink offerings are a very special thing. Turns out drink offerings are wine, a lot of wine, actually, that the priest pours out on the burnt offering on the brazen altar when the roasting of the burnt offering is all done. When the larger the sacrifice, the more wine that's poured out. And you need to get this picture in your head of the drink offering being poured out, the wine, this big amount of wine, depending on how big the offering is, the amount of wine increases with the size of the offering. The drink offering was Yahweh enjoying the offering at the end of the offering of the burnt offering. Okay, so how many of you are chefs here? Even kind of like, you know, amateur chefs. Got a couple of amateur chefs in the bunch? Okay, so what happens, amateur chefs, when you pour the wine onto the meat when the meat is cooking? What happens? Poof! Yeah, right. Flambe, that's right. When it's cooking, you get a big flame up. Flambe, right? So, have any of you ever been to a Japanese teppanyaki restaurant cooking where you got this U-shaped table, you know, and you sit there and there's this Japanese chef and he's got this big hat and he's cooking in front of you and all of a sudden he squirts a little sake onto the griddle and poof, and everybody cheers and everybody's happy and then he makes this little onion pyramid right on the griddle, right? Yeah. And he fills it with sake and then he lights it and everybody, little onion volcano, and everybody's cheering, right? All right, so why do they do that? Well, because as the alcohol is burning off, there's a flavor that goes into the food. The alcohol isn't there anymore, but the flavor, it flavors the food, doesn't it? It leaves a nice flavor. And the other thing it does is leave a wonderful fragrance, doesn't it? The whole room is filled with this fragrance, and the whole place is enhanced by both the flavor and the fragrance of the alcohol that's in the wine or the sake. Now we go back to the Old Testament tabernacle, right? In the temple courtyard, there's this huge, humongous brazen altar standing in the courtyard of the tabernacle and then later the temple. And this thing is humongous. And there's this huge fire. And these entire animals, as big as an entire bull that's roasted on a burnt offering. I think most of us often think of the sacrifices and offerings on the brazen altar as horrific and awful smelling and all. No, folks, this was a huge barbecue. This thing smelled wonderful. There were some wonderful fragrances that were coming off of this beautiful fragrances that were they were roasting these animals in the temple courtyard. And then once they got into the land, they were using these drink offerings at the end of almost every burnt offering was finished off with this wonderful drink offering. And the drink offering was a celebration offering at the end of the offering. And Yahweh was so pleased when the Israelites were coming into the land, and Yahweh was celebrating too. Yahweh was rejoicing too. And you know who received the blessing of the drink offering? Mostly Yahweh. Yahweh was the one who received it. He was the one who received the fragrance of the wine being poured onto the meat and the meat being burned and the alcohol and the sweet-smelling savor. That's what it's talking about in Numbers and Leviticus, when the sweet-smelling savor is floating up into the heavens of the fragrance of the meat and the wine offerings of the drink offering. He was the one who was enjoying the drink offering as the last part of the offering. Now, folks, listen to me. Paul says that he was already being poured out as a drink offering that was being offered to the Lord. Paul was describing himself and his life as an analogy, as a metaphor of a pleasing, sweet-smelling savor that was already going up toward heaven to Yahweh. It was already being poured out. His life was a sacrifice that was already coming out as a sweet-smelling savor to the nostrils of Yahweh up in heaven. His life was being offered up, and it was done now. His sacrifice was done. His departure of his life had already come. Paul was saying his sacrifice to his Savior was a sweet savor to him. He was being received up into heaven. It was a sweet smelling fragrance to the Lord. Yahweh was celebrating Paul's life of service. Yahweh was welcoming his beloved servant Paul, who was coming soon into his presence. Psalm 116, verse 15 says, "Precious in the sight of Yahweh is the death of his saints." What do you think that means? Put these two ideas together, being a drink offering already being poured out. What do you think a drink offering is? What's the purpose of a drink offering? Who's the one who enjoys it? Who's the one who receives it? Who's the only person who receives the benefits of a drink offering? Put 116, Psalm 15, together with 2 Timothy 4:6. Takes on a whole new level of meaning, doesn't it? Folks, the faithful servant of Yahweh dies here. We all grieve, don't we? We gather for the funeral. We grieve our loss. Our loved one has died. We're thankful that our loved one is in heaven, and we're assured that we're going to someday be reunited and we're going to see our loved one. And we grieve our loss, the person that we loved, and the years of separation and all that. But I think we've been missing a big, big point for a long time. Part of biblical material that we've missed. I think we've missed the fact that there probably has been a huge reception. If our loved one has been a faithful servant of Christ that has gone into heaven, Yahweh has apparently welcomed with a great celebration his faithful one. And it's been a big deal, and there's been a big celebration of that person's arrival in heaven. We may grieve their loss here, but I'm getting the impression from this passage and from the Old Testament passage in Psalms 116 that if you're a faithful servant of Christ here in this life, that there is waiting for you upon your arrival there a really, really very big, pleasant, positive, delightful reception by our Savior and Lord Yahweh right there, present, welcoming his beloved child servant home to be with him. And I believe that's what 2 Timothy 4:6 and the drink offering Paul talks about says. I think Yahweh loves him, his drink offering. What do you think? Boy, I want something significant here. What do you think? All right, that's better, much better. It's a big deal. Yahweh loves his drink offerings. Here's the timeless truth that I wrote. 2 Timothy 4:6, Paul says that he is already being poured out as a drink offering. This is a figure of speech wherein the Apostle Paul is likening his life to that of a burnt offering being offered in the Old Testament brazen altar. This is a very specific and really quite graphic and full-blown picture of the end of Paul's life, which is presently taking place with him and what is happening in his life in the near future. In reference to the drink offering, specifically calls attention to the fact that Yahweh is receiving Paul's life of faithful service as a welcome sacrifice that is a sweet-smelling fragrance of the wine of the drink offering being poured out on the burnt offering being offered on the great brazen altar in the Old Testament temple courtyard. Paul will die soon, and he will be received into a heaven with a grand reception by Yahweh for his faithful service. This is what awaits servants of Christ who die having lived their lives of faithful service to him. Precious in the sight of Yahweh is the death of his saints. It is both an Old Testament and a New Testament truth. Yahweh loves his faithful servants. He welcomes them into his presence when they die physically. Hopefully we can say with Paul, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for your wonderful love for us, and you're grateful, and we're so grateful for your eternal salvation that you give us. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for this wonderful little statement in the Scriptures that means so much to us. We thank you that you love us and you care about us, and you look forward to the day when you welcome us into your presence when we come home, if we have been your faithful servants. Pray that you will help us to be faithful servants for you, so that when we do come home to be with you, you can welcome us and celebrate our coming home with a delightful reception as something that is a sweet time of reunion for us with you in heaven. I pray that if there's anyone listening to my voice who has never come to faith in you, who doesn't know about that wonderful gift of eternal life, that at this very moment, Lord, there would be some understanding being gained of what it means to know you and to believe your promise that you will give to them eternal life if they will simply believe your promise. That you will give it to them if they believe in you. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, let's all stand and close.
All of the earth, make straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner, wake up the saint. Let every nation shout of your fame. Jesus is coming soon. So come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. There will be justice, all will be new. Your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing. Even so come, Lord Jesus. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. So we wait for you. God, we wait, you're coming soon. So we wait. We wait for you. God, we wait. You're coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King. Waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come.
Thanks for being here, everybody. God bless you.